I'm delighted to be joined on the line from Cyprus, no less, than none other than Nick Bunyard, the Paulton Rovers manager. Hi, Nick. How are you?
Very well, Ian. How are you?
I'm not bad. This is like Summer Valley Sport International with our man abroad.
Yeah.
But you've chosen to go to Cyprus rather than Brazil.
Yeah, Cyprus didn't swing it to go to Brazil. The wife wasn't having it, so just taking her and the family away for a week.
But you have been keeping an eye on the World Cup games, I believe.
Yeah, I've tried to take in most of them. There's been a few that I've missed, but certainly more all the high profile games I've managed to watch at either at a local bar or we've got an internet stream on at the villa, so I've been watching them on the TV there.
Well, I'm pleased to hear that, because otherwise that would have made this World Cup feature slightly awkward. But were you able to catch the England-Italy game?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, watched that one, unfortunately.
you weren't overly impressed with the performance, then, I can gather?
No. To be fair, I thought the performance generally was okay. And, some of our play going forward was bright and lively. And certainly the young lads that came in did well. We just had a couple of players that didn't perform, and that probably cost us a couple of goals. And ultimately, at that level, it only takes a couple of players not to be quite on their game and get punished. So, I wasn't that disappointed with the overall performance. Obviously, the result didn't go our way, which was disappointing.
Speaking as an England fan, but with your manager's hat on, do you think we should be pleased with the performance and not too bothered about the fact that we weren't able to get at least a point out of that game?
I think that the results ultimately of the World Cup are key, aren't they? So you've got to pick up points. It doesn't matter if you're playing well or playing poorly. I think that from a manager's perspective, Roy had not much choice in the fact that he had to play Leighton Baines because he had the experience over Luke Shaw, but ultimately, I didn't think Baines had a particularly good game, and I am a big fan of Ashley Cole, and although he hasn't played a huge amount of football for Chelsea over the last few months, if you were going over there purely with your results hat on, and you would take Ashley Cole, the guy who's got over 100 caps, he's got such a good defender one-on-one, and I felt that's what, with Rooney in that wide left position, and obviously they had a bit of an overload, certainly for large periods of the first half. Ashley Cole's definitely a better one-on-one defender than Leighton Baines, albeit that Leighton Baines is better going forward than Ashley Cole. So I think that was probably an area that I felt Roy got wrong. But, Leighton Baines had a great season for Everton, so I can see why he went that route.
In terms of the style of the play, would you have rather England had parked the bus and got a point in a bore-all draw, or gave it the go that they did with the exciting young talent of Raheem Sterling?
No, I don't think we had to have the squad or the capability or the quality of player to park the bus. I don't think either fullback in Johnson or Baines are good enough as one-on-one defenders and good enough defensively to play that system. And I think if you look at our midfield and our attack, they're not really a team. As a team, we're not really in a position to be negative and park the bus. So I think, being positive against the Italians was the right tactic. And I don't think necessarily the shape or the tactics were what cost us. We did create chances and we did have chances. So I don't think that he got it wrong from that point of view.
Looking ahead to Thursday, we've got the big game against Uruguay. How optimistic are you feeling?
I'm optimistic in the sense that I don't. Uruguay weren't that great against Costa Rica, and I think that we've definitely got the performance in us to cause them problems. And you'd think if we played to our potential and they played to their potential, we would have enough to win the game. That said, the only thing is having lost the first game, the pressure is now mounted on both sides. In fairness, but certainly our given that we've got a young team, it's a lot of pressure because it's a winner takes all. If we don't get the win, then kiss goodbye to qualification, or pretty much, unless things go, other results go our way and we manage to scrape through. But I think it's pretty much a winner takes all situation. So it's a lot of pressure and expectation. Just hope that the young lads go out and perform which in the main they did. The young lads did well against Italy, so hopefully they'll do it again.
Do you think it helps that perhaps we've got some younger, more inexperienced players in us going into a situation where perhaps more experienced players would feel that pressure more, knowing that it's winner takes all?
Yeah, I think it works both ways. Hopefully they'll have the attitude. I think if you look at Sterling and you look at Sturridge, Welbeck to an extent, where he's not that young anymore, and possibly Barkley coming in, yeah, I think that against Italy, they showed no fear and all performed really well. So you hope that if he does bring in Shaw for Baines, which is one that I would probably look to do, just based on the Italy game, and that if we are going to go all-out attack, you know, Shaw is certainly very comfortable, and he's also, in fairness, a very good one-on-one defender as well. I would look at Shaw, and obviously he has to produce under that pressure, but the other guys have already proven that they can do it. So, we've got good hope.
You mentioned that you'd taken in some of the other matches. What other sides have you seen so far in these early stages of the tournament that have caught your eye?
Well, the two obvious ones, obviously yesterday, the Germans looked very, very strong, which you always know they're going to be if you just look at their side on paper and what they've done in the Champions League over the last few years with Bayern and those sides and Dortmund. They just got such a strong group of players. They're all physically capable. They're all well-drilled, well-organised, as most German teams are. But they've also got a lot of talent and a lot of players that can keep the ball, good energy. They're set and good experience with the likes of Lahm, Schweinsteiger, even Müller at 20. I think he's only 24, and he won the last Golden Boot of the World Cup from really attacking midfield, and he's already scored his hat-trick yesterday. They're there for me. They can cope with the heat and the humidity. They've got to be up there as strong favourites. The Dutch obviously did very well against Spain, but I don't know if they've got enough to go on and really, really challenge to win it. And then Brazil, it's just a case of whether they can score more goals than the opposition, because they're classic Brazil. They're going to be great going forward and great to watch, but they've still got the liability of Marcelo, Alves and Luiz, who are all quite attack-minded defenders and maybe don't concentrate as well as the German sort of back four. Those sides are the ones that sort of spring to mind. And obviously, you've got a few of the outsiders that have done well. And I'm not sure if I watched it a day, got surprised. But obviously, from our group, Costa Rica did really well. One of the other sides, I forget off the top of my head, Ian, got a good result. One of the sides that you didn't expect to.
Chile had a good result, didn't they?
Yes, Chile. They looked strong. So, it's been interesting.
Yeah. Now, just before we let you get back to your holiday, I know you're a man who likes to take his work away with him. Has the management of Paulton Rovers been occupying your mind, or have you been able to put your feet up?
I had a few days where I didn't really think too much about football and what have you, but then after that we have to keep... We're working on a couple of players, bringing them in, and also we had a couple of players that we're just looking to retain from last season that needed just to be sorted out. So I've had to make a few phone calls and send a few messages and all the rest of it, but we're pretty much where we need to be with the squad. We brought in another lad today, Kane Ingram from Western Supermare, who really is probably a like-for-like replacement for Brandon Barnes, who's on his way out to Spain with Nick McCutty. Luke Ballinger's moved to Chippenham, which wasn't really that unexpected. I mean, Chippenham only 10 minutes from Luke, and he's got work commitments and what have you. And given that we signed Kane and John Davies, he wasn't guaranteed to play week in, week out for us. So that was a natural move for him. But we're just looking at a striker that we're still in negotiations with. It might drag on for a couple more weeks yet, but other than that, we're pretty much there, I think.
Nick, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to us, and thank you very much for giving us that exclusive here on Summer Valley FM, and I hope you can enjoy the rest of your holiday.
Cheers, Ian. Thanks, and see you soon.